let's see if we have enough time, because we have a webinar only on these already, which is going to be linked in the page as well, and they can go there and see the whole webinar there. So it's just as if we have more time, we can do this. Otherwise, we just keep it on the presentation.
Sorry, yes. Just to confirm, can you put on presenting mode again, Eduardo?
Yeah.
You see the slides, right? You see everything is still good with this screen share.
Yes.
Okay, cool. A question that I had, Andreas, is will the questions come at the end of our presentation or only at the end of the webinar?
The Q&A session will be at the end of the webinar, I believe. So,
okay. Yeah.
So, Pak Adi,
or are you
the moderator, or I believe there is a
Okay.
So the question, so during the presentation, there is no Q&A, right? The Q&A will be at the after all the speaker has presented, right?
Yeah, perfect. Okay, just wanted to clear that, just so we know.
Or maybe for the first speaker, Pak Director, after he make presentation, we have a short Q&A.
And oh, okay.
If Alex or Mr. Eduardo want the question, or maybe two or three questions after you have a presentation, it's okay. We will discuss it with, or we can deliver it to our moderator.
Okay.
So this specific with Visa Goyo will be make two or three questions your presentation. It's okay, Pak.
Okay.
Okay, Pak Adi, I can understand for the representative from the Directorate General of Mineral and Coal, right? Because of course, maybe he cannot, as usual, right? He cannot stay till the end.
Yeah.
So we will give
Desi from Petromindo, and I would like to welcome you all to webinar Accelerating Mining Digital Transformation in Indonesia, proudly hosted by Coal Metal Asia Magazine and Petromindo. I'm sure today we're going to have a very interesting discussion. Well, as you know, the digital transformation already hit the mining industry, and it is certainly well on its journey. So Industry 4.0 and the advance of automation is now happening in mining industry across the globe. The disruption will replace all physical technologies with digital technology that is completely new, more efficient, and of course, more useful. Artificial intelligence or AI and Internet of Things are the example of some digital technologies that can be replaced the conventional mining industry, which could have an annual economic impact. And on this webinar, we're going to deep dive into why should mining companies start engaging digital technology to increase efficiency in mining production, and how digital transformation could improve efficiency across the value chain in the mining industry. So I would like to give a warm welcome to all speakers and presenters who will join us today. Please welcome the first speaker, Bapak Sunindyo Suryo Hardadi. He's the Director of Mineral and Coal Program Fostering from Directorate General of Mineral and Coal. Selamat siang, Pak Nindyo.
Selamat siang, Mbak Desi. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
Terima kasih sudah bergabung dengan kami di sini, Pak. And please welcome, ya Pak. Please welcome Bapak Darus Hikman, Petrosi Mining Director. Selamat siang, Pak Darus.
Selamat siang, good afternoon, Mbak Desi, and all panelists.
Nice to meet you, Pak, and thank you for your time today. And please welcome our next speaker, Mr. Eduardo Posato. He's the Senior Management Consultant at Visagio. Good afternoon, Mr. Posato, or Eduardo, how should we call you?
Posato is fine. Good afternoon, everybody.
Oh, Posato. Nice to meet you. I'm Desi from Petromindo. Thank you for joining us today. And next, please welcome Mr. Alexandre Sander. He's the Senior Technology Consultant at Visagio. Hello, Mr. Sander.
Hello, nice to be here. Hello, everyone.
Hello, thank you very much for your presence today. And please welcome our moderator, Bapak Hendra Sinadia. He's the Executive Director at Indonesia Coal Mining Association. Selamat siang, Pak Hendra.
Selamat siang, Bu Desi.
Thank you for your support, Pak. And on behalf of the organizing committee, we'd like to deeply thank and give a sincere appreciation to our wonderful partners and sponsor. Please give a warm applause to our main sponsor, TIPCO Software Indonesia. Thank you very much for your great contribution and trust to our work. So ladies and gentlemen, distinguished participants, we'd love to hear from you. So you may type your questions or comments during the presentation in Q&A tab, and we will discuss it later on Q&A session. So without any further ado, I now give the virtual floor to Mr. Hendra Sinadia. Please, Pak Hendra.
Thank you very much, Bu Desi, for the opening. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Hendra Sinadia, I'm Executive Director of the Indonesian Coal Mining Association. I'm assigned to moderate the very interesting topic of the today's seminar. We're talking about digitalizations. As Bu Desi mentioned, that disruptive technology is coming in the mining industry, and we are now living in the Internet of Things, and we are entering into very advanced technology. 5G technology is coming up, and also there is a lot of disruption that can spur the efficiency and effectivity of the mining operations. As mentions that this webinar will discuss some of the interesting topic regarding the digitalizations. We'll cover the government's policy on digital transformation in mining industry, also benefit and challenges in accelerating digitalizations in the mining industry, and the and the arrival of the artificial intelligence in the mining industry, and how mining logistic can prepare for a disruptive technology transforming their businesses. So this a topic of the webinar is very interesting, and I think we've been bombarded in the last few weeks or few months about the decarbonization and natural emissions after the COP26 in Scotland, and now we are moving into the very detailed topic in technology. As we know, technology also plays an important part for mining industry in order to reduce the emissions, carbon emission, because using the technology, the company can, you know, can increase the effectivity, which in turn will ultimately reducing the carbon emission. So technology is a very important part for the company in order to meet the challenges in the decarbonization era. So today we have a lineup of excellent speakers that will present to us the topic, interesting topic. And we will start first with Pak Sunindyo Herdadi. Pak Sunindyo is a director of a program at the mineral and coal department at the Ministry of Energy and Mineral Resources. Pak Sunindyo is, I believe, is one of the part of the team who developed the digitalizations in the mining sectors, and the Ministry of ESDM is, I think, that's one of the most progressive institutions that moving very fast in the digitalizations of the mining permit and also the mining data. As we know that the digitalization in the government matters, it improves the transparency so that public can access the data in real time, and it of course is for the business perspective, it could give the more effectivity and efficiency in doing business. So without further ado, we'd like to give the first ini buat Pak Sunindyo Herdadi untuk presentasi for about 20 minutes, Pak Sunindyo, and followed by a couple of questions if you may to stay. And jadi presentasi dari Pak Sunindyo nanti diikuti oleh questions and answer session langsung. Silakan Pak Sunindyo.
Well, thank you, Pak Indra. Terima kasih for this opportunity, ladies and gentlemen. It's an honor to me to have all of the panelists and the participants for joining this webinar, Accelerating Mining Digital Transformation in Indonesia. Pak Indra, allow me to share screen regarding my presentation this afternoon. Is that already appear?
Yes, Pak.
Yes, okay. You can see the presentations. Go ahead, Pak.
Thank you, Pak Indra. Well, I strictly direct to the slide number 2. In this slide presentation, I would like to emphasizing and quote some of the statement from the several agencies and experts regarding how we conducted the mining industry today. Well, based on the several references, the mining industry right now is need to transform using digital information, because it also will bring the considerable differentiation. Mining has traditionally being slow to adopt the new technology to scale and also the complexity of the operation. And of course the heavy costs and that will come with change. Well, they're not doing a lot the digitalization that already exists. So that's become our challenge for in the future. Well, we believe in the mining sector as a regulation in Indonesia that the digital transformation is not an optional. It's a must, because we learn from many products which right now being become transformation from analog to digital, such as product of Kodak, yeah, camera film. Nobody expected that the brand as large as Kodak is, which dominated the photography industry in the 90s, went bankrupt. The Kodak is the initiator of the digital camera, and yet they still ended up with bankrupt because the lack of the innovation. Of course, many products also become a failure because they did not prepare for the future of the transformation technology. Well, according to next slide, I would like to give an explanation regarding the global trends of the mining industry. The first one is how the mining deposits are increasingly become difficult and expensive to access. Pak Hendra, as a executive director of ICMA, very well known about the stripping ratio, which each day much more become large, the scale of the stripping ratio. It's reflecting how increasingly difficult and expensive mining the coal these days rather than before. And the second is how the commodity price fluctuations. No one can expect, no one can forecast the commodity price fluctuation. Today, we're facing that coal price is rocketing high, and for the mining company, coal mining company, it become a bless, but somehow in the other slot of market, which be facing a difficulties because coal mining company is preferred to export rather than supply their coal production to domestic markets. So that's become one of the situation that we have to facing and we have to manage. So especially how we prioritize the needs of the domestic before we could allow the coal mining company export their coals. And then the third one is how the cost is continue to rise. Of course, if the deposits are increasingly difficult and expensive to access, it become impact to how the cost is continue to rise. And how we manage all of these problems is, the answer is how we transformation with the analog mining situation into the future mining, which is we using digital and technological innovation. Well, on these slides, I would like to give you some of a description how we'll see mining initiative 4.0 transfer from conventional mining into ways that digital transformation benefits mining productivity. It's clear that things need to change for the modern mining companies to increase productivity in the face of a lower budgets and revenue. And then digital transformation brings some benefits compared to conventional mining, such as good system control and good monitoring systems, and use the sensor that would lead to safer, efficient, and more environmentally friendly mines. Okay, next slide. We also see that there are five element digital transformation in the mining industry. First is how we could increase the productivity. Within the implementation of the new technologies and improve operations, including drilling, material blasting, hauling, and it also will improve the productivity of mines. And the second is how we're using the automation system. In the recent years, mining companies have adopted a growing range of digital solutions. Many have mechanized their operations and then move from the physical to digital realm by adding equipment sensors and then adapted unified networks to transmit data. And also automated mining involves the removal of human labor from the mining process. The mining industry is in the transition towards automation. It can still require a large amount of human capital, and in particular in the developing world where the labor costs are low, so there are less incentive for the increasing efficiency. And the third one, innovative technologies. Well, efforts to develop the human resources by utilizing the rapid developments of mining technology continue to be carried out by the company to improve the quality of human resource itself. For example, one of the largest mining in Indonesia, let's say Freeport Indonesia, the company integrates the advanced technology and the advanced of simulator into the heavy equipment operation training program by their technical training department, and which is the part of running an organization. And also there are very useful, yeah, the introduction of machine components and functions, and then application are there useful in technical details how to operate. And the fourth one, the compliance, yeah, with the demands of complying with applicable regulations, and then technology ensure a safer operation, and it can collect and report data on environmental, health, and sustainable issues. And the last one is cybersecurity. This rapid adoption of digital technologies helps to implement new and disruptive business models processes. However, every change involves risk, and cyber attacks and breaches are amongst the bigger risk factors. Since they go hand in hand, and the cyber security needs to support to and underpin this digital transformation. Because the secure data and system are cornerstones business and success. May I proceed to slide number 6? In this slide, I would like also to describe that how the transformation of mining industries is not only a gift benefit to the company, but also it also could contribute the government, such as how the holistic and real-time the monitoring of mining activities will be if we use the this technology, this digital technology. And then the second, we could prevent the non-tax state revenue leakage. And then the third one is how we could formation the better data integration across the ministries and agencies. It will overcome the problem of other sectors. And then the fourth one is how we could increase the public transparency. And also to the mining companies, it will contribute impact how they could increase their productivity, and then also the reduced cost production, and could give a more efficient workforce, and then could reduce the risk of accidents, and much more environmental friendly, and also could use of more suitable equipment. Ladies and gentlemen, how about the next? What to do regarding the government or the mining companies? Well, to achieve a digital transformation in Indonesia, in the mining industry, both of government and the mining companies have to work together. They will have to hand in hand. From the government perspective, several things need to be addressed, such as how we define effective digital standardization, regulation, prioritize the key performance index, and data, improve transparency and traceability. Meanwhile, in the mining company side, they need to align businesses to use innovation in operation, improve data access and relevance, engagement, and train tomorrow's digital workforce, and forge new partnership and strengthen the existing ones. Well, next slides. I would like to describe how we are building the integrated system, the digital transformation in Mineral and Coal, Directorate General of Mineral and Coal. As a government representative, the DGMC, or Directorate General of Mineral and Coal, we have an integrated system application to ensure the faster for the licensing and also the supervising process. Automated workflows promote the transparency by automatically notifying constituents as each step government process is completed. For online licensing at the process, today we now in a way to process with the online service system or OSS from the BKPM, the Investment Coordinating Board, and all the data needed for the licensing will be provided and stored to the Minerba One Data Indonesia, or MODI. Here, MODI. MODI is one of the statistical-based data that BKPM need to issue the license. And then we also have Minerba One Map Indonesia, MOMI. I think MOMI is one of the embryo for the one map policy, because Minerba is the first institution that using the special data to manage all the issuance of permitting. Well, MODI and MOMI, well, data will be, but they're not DADI, yeah? Only MODI, MOMI, okay. Will be used for technical supervision using miners inspector system. It's for our inspector friend to how they could supervising the activity of mining companies. And then the second one is we also built the planning obligations using the electronic RKAB systems. And then for the sales and royalties, we built also the system payment obligation using the electronic PNBP system. And for managing the marketing, we also have systems that call MVP for sales verification, and then MOMS for monitoring online system for mining. And then the last one is we also have a Minepedia. It's a catalog for a domestic component, which can being a reference to the mining companies if they want to buy the equipments. Ladies and gentlemen, in this slide, I would like to describe that this flowchart of digitalization is one of the mining business process based on the law number T2020, and also the interaction with the digital system that available that in the Director General of Mineral and Coal. The process starts with the MODI and MOMI as a basis of the online licensing with BKPM. And at this step, the government ensure that the area that they've been proposed by the proponents is located at the inside the national mining area, and it did not have overlap with other sectors such as plantation or forestry. And the next stage is exploration. Exploration, the mining companies that hold the exploration permit license must report their activity and composing the feasibility study and submit to the government for the agreement. And according to the Ministry Regulation number 7, that IUP and IUPK holder or a mining licenses holder must submit all the data obtained from the exploration to the production according their authority. And the exploration data includes raw data for drill hole data, coring data, survey data, assay and sample, and so on. At the construction stage, the government ensured the company used the local product by the suggesting the company to check the Minepedia for their local component repository for company and suppliers. And also at the mining stages and processing and refining, the government supervise the mining companies using the Minerva Online Monitoring System, or MOMS, to ensure how they conducted accordingly to the year of plan, which is on the RKAB they're being submit and granted. Okay, next one is I think one of the innovation that our colleague in the DGMC, or Director General Mineral and Co, is one done by the mine inspector, is the development of supervising with a remote sensing method, using drone or satellite imagery. This is the kind of the method that give following advantages, such as evaluation of the success mining, ex-mining land reclamation, and based on spatial data, and then the scope of monitoring success of reclamation and post-mining, and then the third one is surface mining progress monitoring. Okay, next one is, this slide is describe how the second innovation of Minerva integrated and engineering environmental reporting system, or miners. This system will help the digitalization of the reporting data and to ensure the effectiveness reporting supervision. And this digital document management also eliminate costs of printing and mining documents. There are six aspects integrated to miners application. The first one is mining technical, and the second is conservation aspects. And third one is standardization and service business. The fourth is mining safety. Fifth one is environmental protection. And the sixth is mastery, development, and application of mining technology. Ladies and gentlemen, the third innovation, MOMS, Minerva Online Monitoring System. This system will give the DGMC benefit of the real-time and accurate data from production, sales, mineral mining balance, and then volumes, values, sales, export sales, and also facilitate the control supervision of national mineral production, and also sales based on approved plan on the RKAB. The system is also give supervision cost for the minerals marketing. And then the next one is electronic PNBP, or electronic non-tax state revenue systems. Well, this system has been developed to improve the administrative efficiency and reduce the administration weakness that potentially reduce the state revenue. So with this system, IPNBP, the state revenue can be calculated correctly and also connected to MODI. It will eliminating the possibility of underpayment. At the same thing, will help the government to use the advanced analytic to identify underreporting with no direct interaction with the permit holder to the government. It also minimizes the chance of a potential of abuse. Okay.
Pak Nindyo, waktunya 3 menit, Pak Nindyo.
Okay. Last slide, Pak, last slide. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, There are digital mining technologies such as machine learning, integrated data and analytics, sensors work, remotes, and then while the innovations and the transformation hold greatly potential, also we believe that mining companies have to go beyond reducing the maintenance costs and implementing the technology solution. In conclusion, this digital transformation will be marks a radical rethinking and how we organize the mining technology and mining management using this digital technology. Thank you, Pak Hendra Senadia, ladies and gentlemen. That's all that I can share with you. And if you have any question, I would be pleased to answer and giving a quiet answer. Thank you, Pak Hendra.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Pak Nindyo, Director of Planning at the Directorate Mineral and Coal, Ministry of Energy and Mineral Resources, for the very comprehensive and informative presentations, Pak Nindyo. Okay, we still have time, 5 to 7 minutes Q&A. If there is any participants would like to raise hand untuk nanya langsung ke Pak Nindyo, atau anybody from the panelists would like to ask questions, a very quick one to Pak Nindyo. Pak Nindyo, you mentioned about 5 pillars, 5 elements of the digitalization in Minerba. Is productions, automations. You mentioned about cybersecurity, compliance, and innovative. Yeah. So in terms of compliance, Pak Nindyo, if we're talking about thousands of mining permits, how's the digitalizations in system digitalizations works in the companies across the nations? How do you monitor that?
Yeah, Pak Hendra, thank you for your question. I think that's one of our obstacles that need the program to overcome, Pak Hendra. We right now coordinating with the local authorities as well, because if we say right now is there is over than 5,000 permits which is active, mostly of them was issued by the local government. So start from the last issuing of the law number 3/2020, and today we are keep communicate with the local government, of course, regarding how they already issued those permit, Pak. And after that, we could manage which one is active and then which one is not, because we also have mandate, Pak, that within in 1 year, if some of the companies which not perform, then we have to decide at our reconsideration the permit to revoke, Pak. Yeah.
Thank you, Pak Nindyo. Yeah, we admit that the digitalizations in the Directorate Mineral of and Coal is very progressive, yeah, compared to other institutions. So, government institutions. Anybody from the panelists would like to address the questions, Pak Andreas atau Pak Iman? Mungkin ada yang mau ditanya ke Pak Nindyo. We still have time.
One of the participants want to ask, Pak.
Okay, please, singkat saja ya, yang dari partisipan, direct question to Pak Nindyo, silakan.
Bahasa is okay, Pak.
Yes, please, bahasa ya.
Please, Pak Joko.
Yes.
Pak Joko, ya, yeah, ini.
Pak Joko bahasa Jawa ini biasanya nih.
Bahasa Jawa.
Primbon Pak Joko, dari Indonesian Mining Association. Monggo Pak Joko.
Please, Pak Joko.
Pak Nindyo, I have read permit from BKPM. That BKM release also permit for the EUP, and I want to ask about the really progress how to apply the permit for the EUP actually.
Thank you, Pak Joko. WEUP, we are not give the BKPM to issue the WUP, Pak. WUP still under the mineral and coal,
okay.
Directorate General to issue, such as for non-metals and coal, non-metals and non-coal, is we're still processing that, Pak, using the online WUP process. So the process is we provided application, Pak. It's open. You can browse it at the website Minerba. and there's also terms and condition and administration process that we evaluate, and then we also using MOMI, Minerba One Map, to evaluating how the area is not overlap with others permit which is already exist, and then we issued the WUP, and then the proponents, Pak, will proceed that WUP to BKPM to issue the IUP, Pak.
Oh, from you, from your side to BKPM.
Yeah, Pak. We WUP still issued by the DGMB, yeah, the Minerba, and then after they granted their WUP, and then they process to IUP, Pak, for the non metal and non coal, for the batuan and
pasir
dan logam. Okay. Ya, gitu, Pak. Untuk pasir, untuk batuan. Kalau untuk for coal and metals, Pak, okay, of course, WUP is process, a bidding process. Hmm. Nah, minister will determine the blocks, and then we conducted the bidding process. Yes. And after that, the proponents will proceed to BKPM, which issued the IUPK or IUP, Pak, for coal and for coal or metals.
Okay. How the estimation about the time, Pak, in India, for applying the license?
According to the SLA, Pak, service level agreement that we already conducted, Pak.
Yeah.
14 days for WIUPK.
Oh, WIUPK.
WIUPK-nya itu 14 hari, Pak.
Okay.
14 days, ya. Yeah. After that, Pak, in a BKPM, that's beyond our jurisdiction, Pak.
Okay.
That's BKPM services, Pak.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Pak Nindyo, for your explanation.
You're welcome, Pak Joko.
Yeah.
Thank you, Pak Joko. Pak Adianto, ada lagi yang dari audiens yang bertanya terakhir mungkin?
Sudah, Pak. Kita ke ini. Sudah.
Oke, okay, saya kira cukup ya pertanyaan buat Pak Nindyo. Thank you very much, Pak Nindyo, for your presentations. It's very informative and insightful. So if you still around, ya, yeah, maybe. Oke, okay, Pak Nindyo. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pak Indra. Thank you, Pak.
Participations. Oke, ladies and gentlemen, we move to the next presenter of the today's webinar on digitalizations. We have the next speaker is Pak Hikman, Darius Hikman dari Petrosi, his Petrosi Mining Directors. A lesson learned: how digitalization drives sustainability, efficiency, and mining operational excellence. As we heard just now, Pak Nindyo from the government has explained about the digitalization application system in the government, which support the productions efficiency and also provide the more friendly environmental business activities, and also support the reduction of greenhouse emissions. So how's the business see the digitalization? We're going to listen from Hikman, yeah, Petrosi Mining Director, with the topic lesson learned: how digitalization drives sustainability, efficiency, and mining operational excellence. Okay, Pak Hikman, mungkin waktunya bisa 15 menit, Pak Hikman.
Baik, thank you very much, Pak Hendra, for giving me the time. I will try to share my screen, Pak. If everyone can see my screen, or Pak Hendra maybe?
Yes, Pak, clear. It's clear, yeah. Okay, we can see it.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Pak Hendra and Pak Nindyo, for giving me the opportunity. This I'm glad and, of course, honored to be here, join with the esteemed speaker on the webinar of whole digital transformation drive the sustainability and the operational excellence in the mining industry. So I will start my presentation by introducing our company. We are Petrosi, the company who has experience more than 49 years in Indonesia. And then we provide end-to-end mining services
And also we are have been partnering with the various scale mining companies in Indonesia. And then through innovation and commitment, Petrosi has launched the what we call the 3D strategy. The first D is diversification, and then digitalization, and then also decarbonization. On diversification, we shift focus to more prospective mineral and geographics. On digitalization, of course, we are now very aggressive on implementing the digital mines, which improve the quality, cost predictability, and the schedule of control. And then the last D is about the decarbonization, how we commit to reduce the carbon footprint. Continue to the next slides. In the last couple of years, we have reached several recognition both national and globally. As we know, we are part of the Global Lighthouse Network from the World Economic Forum. And then also we have been recognized by the IDC and IDCDX Awards for the Operating Model Master Award and also Talent Accelerator Award. Recently, we have also recognized by the Telkomsel on the Frontrunner Award as a Digital Mining Award. And then from this today webinar, I would like to bring three topics. Maybe the first, I will give a little background on mining is the key to Indonesian world economy. As we know, in terms of the contribution to the growth GDP, mining sector has contributed around 4 to 6%. It's equal to 750 trillion rupiah. And then in terms of the mining products of Indonesian export, Indonesia mining has contributed nearly 20% of the total Indonesian export. And then from the data that we have received that from the world ranking 2018 production, of course, Indonesia has a very huge resources and reserve. In terms of number of production, we are the first on nickel production, second on tin, and of course, fifth at coal, seventh at gold, and also the we are the 10th of the copper production around the world. But, and then I continue to the next slide. This is quite interesting topic that now in the last couple of years that we are very familiar with the energy transition, which resulting the differentiated of resources. One of the triggers, as we know, is the Paris Agreement 2015. It has arise the new industry, which is some of them are electric vehicle industry, wind energy, which is a renewable energy, and also the electric plants. So according to the data that on 2040, the market size, especially on the nickel, copper, and aluminium, it will predict to significantly bigger, which is almost 10 times from the current market size. This is quite a huge opportunity for us, mining industry Indonesia, on how we diversifying our resources to the mineral sectors. Meanwhile, as we know, Indonesia has a significant reserve, but there is some notes on that there is still known as this small amount we spend on the exploration stage. Of course, this is a huge opportunity for us on how we exploring more on the exploration on the resources, especially on the mineral resources. So continue from the energy transition, Pak. What we have seen, there are three main impacts on the energy transitions. We'll start from the first one. We believe that the increased commitment to clean energy is more strength now. Renewable energy become now cheaper and more efficient, of course. And then the second one is about the greater demand of the consumptive of material. What does it mean? It means the impact will be more minerals mine needed to fulfill the demand, and also the government also has emphasized to be more proactive for the industry player on the downstream industry, and then more smelter to be developed in the recent years. And then the third one is about the growth of electric vehicle. Of course, this is required the huge demand of the minerals mine, and then it will require the commitment from the industry player and the government on how Indonesia to boost the exploration program and then also the production, of course. So from what we have seen here, as Pandinjo just said on the previous presentation, so the digital transformation is a must for us, not only for the Indonesian player, but also for the government. So yes, the urgency of digital transformation is very critical for the Indonesian player and also for us even to adapt to stay remain competitive in the industry, and then of course to how we maintain the sustainability. Okay, and then I will go to the second part of the presentation. Mine life cycle indicates the opportunities of the innovative solutions. This is the technology adoption in mining. I think now we believe covers across the entire value chain of the mining. Start from the pit optimization, pit to port supply chain, and also digital marketing and sales. If you can see here, we have been identified 20 plus potential use cases to be deployed to the mining operation, which of course will trigger to the effectivity, efficiency, productivity, and of course the better and lower mining operating costs. What we have been experienced in the last couple of years, we have implemented the digitalization at the pit operation, and then also of course the digital reliability on how we maintain our equipment on asset strategy, and also the pit to port supply chain, and also the digital procurement, and then up to the digital marketing and sales. So we are quite very enthusiastic to see the opportunity on how we boost the digital transformation across the value chain in order to get the benefit of cost competitive, and also as Pak Nindyo previously said, also about the how we extract more resources by the having lower operation cost. Yeah, continue to the next slide. This is our fourth year of the digital transformation in our company, Petrosi. So what we have been doing now is focusing on the next stage of digital transformation. The first one is ROC, Remote Operation Center. I will explain it further. And second one is about the advanced analytic. And then the third one about the future development of the autonomous mine. Yes, there's a bit pro-cons on the autonomous mine here in Indonesia. But again, the aim is significantly improve the efficiency, productivity, and of course, the one of the biggest impact is the increasing the safety and sustainability. Okay, this is our ROC, Pak, Remote Operation Control. We have launched the Remote Operation Center at Jakarta this year. So with Remote Operation Center, we are able to monitor, control all the operation in real-time basis and covers all project sites that we have been performing at across in Indonesia. And then I move to the second use cases about the advanced analytics. The beginning period of when we start the digital transformation, we are started from the diagnostic analytics, but now we are moving enhancing our capability to more advanced analytics. There are three use cases that we have been developing so far. The first one is about the fuel and road analyzer. As we know that fuel is one of the biggest costs in the mining operation. And then second one is the fleet dispatch optimization. And then the third one is the streamlining the main planning. So what is the difference between the previous digital products, which based on the diagnostic analytic and then the advanced analytic? At the fuel road analyzer, what we call it, for example, previously, we just monitor the performance of the trucks, operators, based on the real-time data, but only we do the diagnostic and giving or feeding the real-time data to the supervisor. But now, using the advanced analytics, we able to provide not only the data but also the impact and prediction of what will happen in the future or in the next hours of the operation, and what the supervisor should do immediately to reduce the bigger impacts to happen. And then same with the previous use case on the fleet dispatch optimization. Also, we are launching the what we call the truck simulator. We can give the prediction of priority road to be fixed or priority road to be maintained in terms of the impact of the cost of operation. So at the end, we can see again the better predictability cost and maintaining the lower operating cost on the how we operate our fleets. The last but not least, the use case is streamlining mine planning. This is very much required by the mine owner and also the government on how we control our execution of mine planning to be more accurate in terms of quality and quantity, and also the transparency data of transmitting the data, the production to the one dashboard. And also in this use case, we can show the predicted cost or the impact if one activity doesn't happen and impact to another activities in the execution of mine planning. So there are the three of use case based on advanced analytics that we are developing now and implementing. So on this slide, I would like to share our experience after 4 years we implemented digital transformation. So yeah, digital transformation has enabled us to connect the workforce, to connect the equipment, the connected workforce through the what we call Minerva apps. So all the supervisor using the same apps, operator using the same apps, they are accessing the same data information. And then we also able to connect the equipment through fleet management system. And then the last one also, we able to connect the sites, which is now we can easily remote our operation from Jakarta head office for the entire our operation at Indonesia is about 6 to 8 projects currently we have now. Yeah, there are quite massive impact from digital transformation. Maybe I can share here that we have experience and we reach the benefit from the digital transformation. 5 to 10% we can increase the reserve and increase the lifetime, of course, of the mine. And then we identified, we recognized the 20 to 35% of the lower operating costs. And then also one of the most important impact is about the safety. We can reduce the number of frequency rate injury is about to 30 to 70%, Bapak-Bapak, Ibu-Ibu. Yeah, I come to the last part of this presentation. Of course, now we can spread the digital transformation with the ESG. We have committed that ESG is a part of our transformation, again triggered by the Paris Agreement in 2014 and then the recent COP Glasgow. So now not only the industry player, companies and also the government now have more pressure from the stakeholder to be more environmental friendly, and then we are expected by having to have the very clear action plan on how we achieve the zero emission target that Bapak Ibu. So this is the last part of my presentation. So in terms of the digital transformation, we have embed the ESG, environmental, social, and governance there are some several use cases that potentially deploy to these initiatives. Some of them are have been started in our operation. The first one is, of course, how we reduce the carbon from the operation. Now we are starting to engaging some of the partner on how we retrofitting or even to deploy the electric vehicle to our operation. And then while we have implemented the several digital use cases, including the digital iPhone analytics on how we reducing the fuel consumption in our operation. And then the second one, of course, on how we enhance the renewable power source from the grid or self-produce. One of the premium solution is solar panel. And also now we are very aggressive on developing the capability on hydropower to, again, to align with the sustainability and the more environmental friendly mines. The last but not least, of course, as a part of the ESG, we also committed to the gender diversity and equality. We have female representation in the BOD level, and then also the female workforce through the female operator. I think that's the presentation from me, and yep. Then happy to discuss and answer the question, Pak Hendra, and all the panelists. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Pak Iman, Pak Darus Hikman, Petrosi Mining Director, for the very informative presentation. So we'll get back to you later in the Q&A. You mentioned several important lessons learned in your presentations, one of which is the move toward the ESG. Yeah, this is something that become a trend that the company has to pay more attention on the ESG aspect. And also you mentioned about the impact, positive impact of the digitalization to your the productivity, also in safety, yeah, can reduce a lot of facility, fatality and improve the safety measures in the your operations. And also transformation technology is a must, and digitalization is the a key to the more efficient and effective mining operation. Okay, thank you, Pak Iman. We'll get back to you later in the Q&A. Next, we're moving to the presentations, brief presentations from TIBCO Software Indonesia, a company that's sponsoring this event. So, Pak Andreas Kagawa, yeah, from TIBCO, please, your time.
Yeah, thank you, Pak. Izin Pak ya, saya share screen Pak.
Silakan Pak Andreas.
Sudah kelihatan Pak? Ya, sudah kelihatan Pak ya?
Sudah Pak.
Ya, sudah ya. Pak.
Oke, teman-teman para hadirin sekalian, saya mix mungkin ya bahasa Indonesia, bahasa Inggris. So again, it is our pleasure to be able to contribute to the mining industry by sponsoring this event. And as like people say, ya, tak kenal maka tak sayang, so allow me just to spend like few minutes to share what TIBCO is, right? So TIBCO is basically, we are a software company, Pak. We are founded in 1997, so it's 24 years ago, and our headquarters in the Palo Alto, Pak. Currently, we are privately owned company, but back in 2014, our revenue worldwide is already more than $1 billion. Jadi, revenue kami sudah $1 miliar itu di tahun 2014-an ya. Tentunya sekarang makin besar ya. And then the uniqueness of TIBCO, Pak, we only care about the power of data. Ya, jadi we provide a software solution end to end. Mainly on the data. Why? Because we believe data is the most valuable asset that the company can have, right? And then in the digital transformation, the challenge is that about the data, right? Because why? Kenapa? Karena data is fragmented, data is inconsistent, and also there is a disparity of data. Jadi dari judul di saat ini tentang digital transformation, sebetulnya salah satu challenge utama itu adalah tentang data. Kenapa? Karena data itu fragmented ya, terpisah-pisah di berbagai macam aplikasi, departemen, sudah fragmented, nggak ada yang komplit, lalu juga inconsistent gitu ya, bisa berbeda-beda data, apakah itu tentang data supplier, aset, customer, produk ya, dan sebagainya, itu bisa berbeda-beda di tiap aplikasi. Nah, oleh karena itu TIBCO ingin membantu ya suatu perusahaan di termasuk di mining untuk juga memberikan jawaban tentang data ini. Nah, kami ada suatu solusi yang kami sebut, we call it a connected intelligence, and it has three pillars, is a connect, unify, and predict. Paling gampang lah, ingatnya CUP ya, kayak a cup of coffee every day gitu Pak ya, seperti secangkir kopi, secangkir teh. And then these three pillars is basically represent how the company journey to have not only a good data, but also how to use this data, more than just data, but become an insight to make a better decision. Jadi our first pillar itu kita sebutnya sebagai connect. Ya, jadi dalam connect ini kita able to connect all the data from different various application, resources, device, IoT. Jadi kami bisa menggabungkan, mengintegrasikan semua data dari berbagai aplikasi, sumber data, dan peralatan, devices. Lalu setelah kita bisa mengintegrasikan, bisa collect that data, pertanyaan berikutnya kita mau diapain nih datanya? So we can unify. So we basically unify, give a single point of truth, single point of view about the data, so that the company can intelligently have a better access, trust, and control. Jadi kami biasanya suka sebut sebagai golden record gitu ya. Datanya itu dibersihkan, di-clean, ada the truth of the data. Nah, lalu sesudah data itu sudah bersih, sudah rapi, sudah cakep gitu ya, kita menggunakan data itu untuk apa? Nah, tadi seperti Pak Iman Darus ya menyampaikan bahwa di Petrosi sendiri, sekarang yang namanya analytics itu more than just menganalisa historical data, tapi juga ada ability untuk melakukan prediction. Nah, ini juga sebagai pilar ketiga dari TIBCO, yaitu tentang predict. Jadi kita tidak hanya berhenti untuk menganalisa, tapi juga bisa mempredict what happen ya, yang terjadi ya, baik secara opportunity revenue atau kita bisa mitigate risk ya. Dan TIBCO, last but not least, we are a globally trusted perusahaan, dan seperti Bapak Ibu lihat sebetulnya kami most of the big company in many industries is in our customer. Di telco, life science, high tech, food and beverage ya, termasuk di Indonesia juga kita sudah more than 5 tahun di sini. Customer kami all the biggest telco ya, lalu juga one of the biggest banking private, lalu transportation sudah menjadi customer kami, and then we are more than happy to also to contribute in the mining industry. So I think this is just basically our solution ya. But then with that, I will pass to the next speaker, our partners focus in mining industry from our Visa Geo friends. Yeah, thank you, Pak Hendra.
Thank you very much, Pak Andreas Kagawa from TIBCO, global leader in the software. You mentioned about the software can unify the web of
the enterprise scattered data, Pak.
Yeah. Data scattered everywhere. It's like a web jaringan, so yeah, the TIBCO can able to unify, integrate. I think that's something that very appeal, I believe, to the industry. And also your system is a three pillar of your system: analytical, predict, and you know, you mentioned about golden record, yeah, something
like that. Yes, connect, unify, and predict, a cup of coffee.
Yeah,
we'll see how the solution later when Visa Geo give the solution, Pak. Yeah, of course, combined with their expertise and their solution as well.
Okay, in the next Pak Andreas. Yeah, very interesting conversation. Thank you, Pak Andreas. We'll get back to you later in the Q&A. Okay, we're moving to the next presenter. Bagi peserta yang ingin bertanya, ingin ini langsung lewat Q&A chat ya, dan nanti raise hand jika pada saat Q&A sessions. Oke, okay, before we move to the Q&A, we have two presenters from Visa Geo, a case study on the use of mining accelerator, which is designed to quickly provide available intuitive metrics of resource operations from pit to port. We have two excellent speakers from Pisagio. First is Mr. Pasato, yeah, Eduardo Pasato, senior management consultant of Pisagio. And second speaker, Mr. Sanders, Alexander Sanders, senior technology consultant at Pisagio. So your time is 30 minutes for you, both of you, gentlemen.
Hi, everyone. Can you guys hear me?
Yes, loud and clear. Thank you.
Awesome. I will start by sharing my screen as well. Let me know if you can see my screen as well and I'm ready to start.
Yes, we can see the screen. Yeah.
Awesome. Please. All right. Good afternoon, everyone. Again, I'm Eduardo. I'm here with Alex. We are from Visagio. And we're here today to talk a little bit about two examples of how when we look in local and some specific applications, digital transformation works in the mining companies. So we've just seen two presentations that explains overall the benefits and lessons learned, like the last one, which was pretty good. But first, before we get into it, I would like to introduce a little bit about what's Visagio. So Visagio is a management consulting firm that was founded in 2003, so less than 20 years ago. And we already delivered projects in over 40 countries. We are in Perth, in Sydney, in Australia, Brazil, and also with offices in London, Berlin, and Moscow. So basically, we started in mining. Basically, on one of our first companies, one of our first clients was Vale. And since then, we've been expanding our projects in the mining industry and gathering experience and gathering knowledge in this area. But that's not why I'm here. So we're here to talk a little bit about one story, or actually two. So the first story we're going to talk about is the story of Julia. So Julia is a general manager, and she, as many general managers around mining companies, is responsible for many, many things within the industry, within the company. She needs to report and make decisions based on data, on everything from exploration to health and safety, environment notification. Everything is under her control. And it's true, we know that every day that goes by, the amount of data that a company is creating is increasing exponentially. So as the data that's created expands like this, it's expected that agility and assertiveness in this leader's decision-making process increases. But what we ended up seeing is that that's not actually the case right away. So the big challenge in this case for a general manager in the mining company is that there is a lot of lack of a standardization in this data. So it starts by having many, many systems. So we have one system for your safety, you have another system to control your real-time data, and that ends up creating knowledge silos. So you have a group of people, and anyone that works here in the mining industry knows that, you have some groups of people that know about that system and another group of people that knows about the other system. And you ended up not talking the same language within the same company. This is due to the fact that most of these processes, they ended up having decentralized databases. Some of them will work with SAP databases or another system for health and safety. They have different ways to query the data, different ways to analyze the data. So if you don't have any solution that optimizes this data gathering and treatment, you ended up having a real-time constraint on gathering it, because you depend on many, many people to get that information, which ended up delaying for Julia or a general manager to actually get the data and make decision on a timely basis. So what happened in this case? So Julia presented this challenge to Visage and say, I'm not being able to get this data on time. I have so much information to gather. I have so many things to make decision and so many people to actually bring the data for me, that from the data ingestion in the company where we have our workflows all the way to the decision-making, it was taking too long. So that's why we look at the challenges and risks that was involved in there, and we decided to create the intuitive mining dashboard, which basically starts by looking at the different types of data ingestion and assess the processes that exist in there. So basically, we analyze all the systems, what type of data they manage, how is the integration between these systems, is it already in a DB or you have a lot of spreadsheets around in Excel and people controlling rosters, how is the real-time systems integrated, and etc. But also, it's more one of the things that's really important is even this part is important to understand the business processes behind and how to integrate them and how to make sure we add value to this general manager, or in this case, Julia. So once we understand all of this, that's when Tibico came in. So using Tibico Spotify, which is one of the solutions that Tibico uses for creates for visualization, we are able to do everything that we needed to do for the solution. So when you think about the whole digital transformation, you need to understand where we are, where we want to get, and what is possible to do at this moment. So what was possible to do for Julia could be done in Spotify, because we needed to get all the sources and create a data model that allowed for us to see all this data in one single location. So we needed to be able to create some advanced analytics, put some really nice looking visualizations and sending alerts and emails, also identifying trends and forecasting specific events and et cetera, everything in one single location. So basically, this is what we created. We create a one-stop shop solution that is capable to provide all of these insights in one single location, providing standardization and really, really speeding up the process from the data being consolidated in the mine all the way to decision-making, and of course, mainly when you have alerts. So we actually have a webinar full-time on this already that is on this link here. If you go visage.io/mineaccelerator, you can see 40 minutes where we drill down into every single page and explain how everything works. So just to give you a little bit of overview, what we have is a landing page that works as an executive summary that can be on a TV, on a screen, where we have everything from geology to processing, maintenance notifications and work orders, and health, safety, and environment, and allows you to see some big numbers for that week or that day right away in the first page. And if you want to drill down into a page where it gives you more information about it, it's very straightforward to do. So what's the power here? What did we deliver? So in the end, what's important to understand is that we didn't deliver one dashboard or one solution, because the big success about this case is understanding which solution is the most appropriate at the moment. For us to understand which solution is the most appropriate at the moment, the first thing you need to do is understand the current maturity of that company, of the mine site, of the department. So there is three levels of digital of maturity that is analyzed. So the digital maturity, the process and people, and also what are the company levers? Mainly what that means is what is your goals short and long term. So in this case, when we build the intuitive mining dashboard, we can right away define that it will increase the digital maturity of your organization, because at one point you are making decision based on your gut feeling, because the data is not there at the moment you need the data. And now you're making decision based on data because the data is timely available in a dashboard. One of the great outcomes of having a dashboard such as this one is that this type of dashboards, we also provoke good conversations within the organization. So now that we have more timely information, what's the next step? That's the big power of it. So, what's next? So first is we go through this journey of building this digital mining intuitive mining dashboard, which has everything that one like general manager needs to know. So we started from your preliminary analysis, this define your digital maturity, what needs to be done, and then go through the governance of implementation. So how would that work in like a little bit more detail? So basically, we need to first define what are your value drivers, right? What are the company levers? So basically, is it risk mitigation? Is it the most important thing for the moment? Is it productivity increase or so on? Once we define what are the company levers, the next important thing is understand the new technology that create opportunities for us to exploit these levers. So for example, if you want to increase productivity and you have possibility of using automation to do it, that's the next step for it. So a good example is in the simplified supply chain of mining, when we have all the stages and your cross business functions. Let's say we are in exploration in geology. What would be a few examples of this technology and using the technology to explore the levers? Could be earth sensing or autonomous drilling and sampling. Or for example, for mining, could be predictive maintenance for key equipment and some issues or highly adaptable operations with AI. So all of these could be used to define the examples. But now I'll pass on to Alex, and he's going to enter a little bit more in detail on the methodology.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Eduardo. So as Eduardo has mentioned, it is interesting to note that within the journey of digital transformation, it is important to understand your origin point. So where are you starting from? What is your digital capacity at the moment? And how does a roadmap look like for you to generate the value that you want to generate? So as it was mentioned in other presentations before this one, the digital transformation has arrived to most sectors at the present time, the mining sector in special. And essentially it has become a matter of survival for many companies to adapt to this, to become digital, to improve on their processes and to really ensure that they can polish the methods that they assess these things. So what we're talking about in this slide is basically the methodology that Visagio utilizes whenever we are going through this opportunity of getting a digital maturity assessment with one of our clients, right? So it is basically a framework composed of four main steps. So the first main steps are preliminary assessment and engagement. This is where we will sit down, understand the problem, the pain points. This is a very comprehensive exercise. We understand the viewpoint of leadership layers. We understand the viewpoint of operators. We even do visit to site if that's relevant to that particular assessment. The output of this engagement is what we call a maturity diagnostics. So the maturity diagnostics goes back to what I mentioned in the beginning of your origin point. It will show you the things that you are already doing pretty well. It will show you the opportunities that you have to continue evolving, and it will also show you how your future looks like. And this leads to step number three, which is the roadmap development. So this has a lot to do with the ability to select your priorities the right way, the ability to experiment and fail fast and make sure that you are moving in the right direction. And last but not least, it's the engine that supports all of the before. It's the governance and implementation. So whenever we pick up our priorities, we inform our diagnosis on the maturity. It's important to have a method, a framework in place that can make sure that development is healthy and fit for purpose in every iteration. So. And then I'm just going to go into a little bit of detail on each of these steps. But essentially, when we're talking about the preliminary assessment and engagement, we're talking about a kickoff. So it's very important that we start with the right foot in this. This means getting every stakeholder, getting every relevant piece of information aligned in terms of expectation from the get-go. If the kickoff is successful, then we start going for the interviews, which is the next piece of the puzzle. We make sure that we contact everyone that needs to be contacted, everyone who is leading this process, or everyone that is depending on this process to do their work. We also do visit to sites. And from all of that, the final outcome of this first assessment is just to come up with a list of opportunities. What you see in this slide are basically the six levels of digital maturity that Visagio usually works when applying the framework. So you have step one, digitization. The main intention of this step is to measure how well are your processes defined in the digital space. How much are you still dependent on manual aspects? How much are you not optimized in the things you do, and how much can be accelerated by incorporating digital aspects? We then move on to connectivity. So connectivity is the ability to So once you're inside the digital space, the connectivity maturity is when you're able to connect your different digital spaces into one big ecosystem. And that the ability to connect it all into a different ecosystem is what gives you layer number three, visibility. It's the ability of seeing things on an end-to-end perspective and using that in your favor to bring diagnosis, to bring next steps, to bring data-driven decisions, basically. With that, with those data-driven decisions, you start going in a perpetual improvement cycle. That's your transparency layer. And with a lot of that improvement cycle, there will be a point where you will stop looking at the present and you will be able to, with much more clarity, look into the future and being able to predict what is the direction to take even before issues arise. So this is the moment where we start evolving from something more reactive towards something more proactive in the way that we act. And the very last step is adaptability. So when we have the ability of understanding the present, foreseeing the future and all of that, we are ready to then become adaptable to the world and what it is, what it has to offer. And then, of course, from that, from the diagnosis that we do, you will be placed in one of those layers of maturity. The idea right here is to move on to the next step, which is the roadmap development. So if you know where you are, and if you know what you have to walk towards, then there's a number of instruments and frameworks that Visagio helps clients apply in order to understand how the sequence of events happen, or what to address first, what brings high value with low effort, what are the low hanging fruits, all of that. And then last but not least, the entire cycle of keeping this alive and continuously improving is the agile methodologies that we apply on every single one of these implementations. So this is not about setting up deadlines for 6 months ahead in the future and delivering them. This is about continuous improvement and continuous delivery that will make sure the team can see the value right away and can continue improving on what's already working. So one of the cases that we explored was the Intuitive Mining Accelerator. And the Intuitive Mining Accelerator was put in place to address the most common metrics, the most common questions that have to be answered in the mining context today. But we did bring another example, and this is the story that I'm about to tell you. For this one, we have created the persona of Irene. So Irene is going to be representing a real client from a project that Visagio has is very proud to have participated on. So in this particular success case, we'll be going into the step of mine planning. So mine planning is a very critical part of the supply chain of any mining business. And the reason why this is so critical is for someone like Irene, who's a mine planner, to make sure that her job is done right. There are many assumptions, there are many aspects that have to be considered when coming up with the mine plan. So you have product quality that you have to make sure to meet. You have production targets. You have the capacity that your equipments at the sites can produce. You have to make sure to be adaptable to changes. If you're designing a plan that is supposed to predict the next 3 months of production, then it is likely, and it happens often, that you know changes may happen, like you may have a shutdown or an equipment may break, or there are weather conditions that might provoke you to change and adapt and publish a new plan. So all of these balls are in the air, and Irene is the planner who's responsible to work on this. One of the main reasons that this is so difficult is because when we're talking product quality, production targets, equipment capacity, all of these things can be decentralized in a company that is yet adapting to the digital space. So it's the same as Posato has mentioned on the other examples. If you're dealing with product quality, if you're dealing with equipment production capacity, if you're dealing with targets and safety and all of those aspects, it is important that you have a way for all of this data to come together and tell a story. If they're being stored in different places, in different platforms, it's very risky that you will have difficulty in making decisions or in making sense of what's being shown to you. So the solution that we were developing with Irene had to make sure, and this is the first circle on this slide, had to make sure that information would come together and tell a story, will show a context. Another thing that we did have to make sure when developing the solution is that in the event of a change or unforeseen event, whatever we were building to improve their process should be able to adjust to change in a quick way. So they need to be fast in change. And the ability of having contextualized information, an easy way to test changes and compare different scenarios, is what's going to give you to the third circle, which is opportunity identification. If you can test things quicker, you can generate insight quicker, and you can drive a more optimal, a better plan that way, as well as obviously being more protected across your risks. So what I'm going to do for this one is I'm going to explain a little bit about the architecture. So this is where we get into the technical space of what we've done. So what you can observe there in the very first column of this diagram is the contextualization bit. So all you see in there are the different systems in the mine, the different systems in the mining company feeding different information. We had to make sure that that information gets collected from each individual source and stored and transformed and treated to make sense in one centralized location. So this was one of the main things that we try to achieve with that. After that, we made sure to utilize typical Spotfire as the front end layer of this. So everything that users would be seeing, what they would be manipulating, all the interactions would be done using typical Spotfire as the platform. And one of the things that are fantastic about typical Spotfire as a tool is the ability to go beyond visualization. So typical Spotfire has very powerful features to actually bring the tool aspect into visualization. So you're not only using it for reporting, you are also using it for interrogating information, for analysis, for driving insight. So what we have done for this particular solution is we have connected Spotfire into what we call a scenarios DB. So every time you publish a plan using this tool, that plan gets versioned and stored into a database. And that means it's easy enough for users in the tool to retrieve different plans and do comparisons in real time, all in the same place without having to leave the typical Spotfire environment. So what we brought in to highlight this a little bit further is we brought in some animations of how the tool works. So basically what you're seeing in there is the landing page. This is what users will see as soon as they open the tool. You can see that you have different buttons there on the bottom to the monthly consolidation module of the tool, to the maintenance viewer, to the plant capacity. This is really important because when this tool was developed, this was the first time that all of this information could be located into one place. So this is the beginning of our journey towards a better usage of data and better storytelling. And also in the center of that page, you can see there's a table in there with different tabs. This was basically one of the ways that the tool provided for the department to communicate with their users. So you could use that area in the center to inform people about recent changes or recent updates. You could use that to have more clarity on like what data sources are being used for this tool to do what it does, and who do you contact in case you need to do some troubleshooting or if you have any questions on the number. So all that idea of a universal one-stop shop was one of the key drivers when developing this solution. This right here is an example of one of the pages that we have. This is what we call the monthly consolidation page. And the main intention of that page was to show people a summary of the current version of the plan so people could analyze it. So on the top of the page in there, you should be able to have some filterings that you can manipulate. So you can see how a specific mine site is performing on the plan or how a specific type of product is performing on the plan. You can change the granularity of time in that plan to see things in a weekly perspective versus a monthly perspective, which was quite common in the, you know, in the context of our planners. And also on the bottom left, we do have the graph there, the bar graph there, that is basically showing us how the product blend is going to work when we ship product to our clients. So it's really important that you realize products that will be a big part of your blend and products that you have to be more careful about meeting quality demands against other products. So all of that information giving you the quickest possible way to visualize how your plan is looking. So that was the first layer of driving insight. After that, we do have some complementary pages, obviously, to check on that plan and drive insight. So the one that you are seeing right now is what we call the gray tracking. So this was a module in the tool specifically designed for you to track if you're compliant with grade. The lines you see yellow and red are your targets, and you can see if in a certain point in time, things are going to go off spec. And what's cool about this one is that some products may be a blend of different sub-products. So the tool gives you the ability of breaking down a blend into the specific products that compose that blend. So you can investigate exactly which point, which product at which point in time started to drive the target away. So this particular aspect of the tool was substantially important for you to understand where your action needs to take place. This is not a guessing game. This is not a bunch of random phone calls anymore. This is literally about knowing in the spot, where do you have to act and how. And then this right here is what we call the parameters page. And this is the key feature that we have in this tool. This is what makes everything come together. Basically, what you have in there is a bunch of auxiliary tables that will inform you how your raw data is showing you how the plan is going to behave. So you have a timeline and you have a list of equipments, and you can see the availability of equipments, you can see utilization, you can see the rate of equipments. And this is the interface that we have given our users to manipulate the plan inside the tool. So basically in that area there in the middle where it says capacity parameters, users should be able to select a piece of equipment and input custom parameters. So an example of that would be, okay, let me input a parameter where this equipment will be broken in this particular day. Or let me see what happens if I decrease the capacity of this equipment in half. Let me see how that impacts my plan. So this was basically a screen for users to play around with different scenarios of the plan. And once they have submitted their changes using this page, they could navigate to all the other pages in the dashboard to have access to views like that one. So if you pay attention to the bar chart at the very bottom of this page, you will see that there's an orange line and a purple line. What you're seeing in that graph is basically a comparison. The orange line is the capacity of your equipments, and your gray bar is the production plan that you have at the moment. So you can see how distant, for example, you can see how distant your production plan is from your capacity, and that helps you assess opportunities for improvement. But not only that, what you see in purple there is the scenario that contains the changes we've made to the plan. So it's easy for a user to go back into that parameters page, change a capacity of an equipment, put something into maintenance, increase availability, go back to this page and just observe the purple line, for example, to see how something would impact. So this is quite easy for users to simulate. And like I said, when I was showing the architecture, all of these different scenarios that are being generated by this tool, they are being stored in what we call a scenario database, and users can retrieve and compare multiple scenarios dynamically. So if I would save a scenario in this tool, I could go back to Eduardo and say, can you please load this scenario on your end and have a look at what I come up with? So it was much easier for different planners to align on what adjustments should be made and how to contact site to perform such adjustments. So this is basically the summary of the planning consolidation tool.
I guess it's important to mention as well, we've written an article about these tools recently, and the big thing here that proves the value of this tool was the client mentioning that before they had this tool, until they get all the consolidation and the decisions made for the next plan, it was already too late in the month and they couldn't make any change. And now because of this tool, they are able to do all the changes and plan 3 days before the month end, which is the target that they had. And they evaluate that they are reducing possible risks of fines and any other costs that would be incurred from not being able to hit their grade target in millions of dollars a year.
It's also important to mention that this tool supports multiple timeframes or different plan spectrums, as in May. So you usually have long-term plans, let's say a yearly plan, and that yearly plan usually serves as the baseline for you to come up with your monthly plan, and then the monthly plan is a baseline for your weekly plan, that's a baseline for your daily plan. So the tool is actually able to bring all of these different baselines together so you can easily compare and test adjustments on that spectrum as well.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's why it's called planning consolidation tool as well, because it consolidates all the plans in one and easy for them to visualize and play around with it. All right, so that is it. So how do I start my transformation journey now? So we've seen a few presentations today that show how some of these companies are already doing it, how you're seeing this around. What we prepared is we've been doing a lot of digital maturity analysis recently. We realized this is the best way to start instead of simply going and doing like a tool, an analytics dashboard, or jumping straight to AI. I think the first thing is to understand where your department, where your processes, where your company is positioned in terms of a digital transformation journey. So basically what we prepared is we are like creating a partnership here with Tibico as well, where we're going to do a digital maturity assessment for your department if you're getting in contact with us. So you just register in the link above. We're going to get in contact with you and ask some questions, do some of those meetings that we explained that happens in the first stage, and give you a report that shows you where is your department in terms of the digital maturity, what could be the next things that needs to be done. Because sometimes we look at artificial intelligence, for example, and say, oh, I really want to do some artificial intelligence solution, but you might not be there yet in terms of data quality, data robustness. So there is a few stages that need to be understood before. So we're happy to support your department in your company in doing this to help as a first step. And I guess that's it for now. We'd like to thank again very much Petromindo for the chance and Tibico for sponsoring the event and inviting us. Feel free to contact me or Alex as well. And thank you again.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much for the very informative presentation from Mr. Eduardo Passato, Senior Management Consultant at Visagio, and Mr. Alexander Sander, Senior Technology Consultant at Visagio. So for the all webinar participants, please take the opportunity to do the digital maturity assessments offered freely by Visagio. Yeah? So don't lose this very a rare opportunity. Yeah, you mentioned Alex about the a good mining plan is needs to be optimal and polished. Yeah, so I think that's a very clear message to the mining company to, you know, to embark later on the journey in digital to do the diagnosis, to have the digital assessment, do the diagnostic, and then Visagio offer the very comprehensive plan indeed. Okay, so we still have time for Q&A. Unfortunately, Pak Sunindyo is no longer joining with us. He has to attend an offline meeting, so he regret to all the participants. But we still have the gentleman here to ready to respond all questions from the audiences. Okay. Sorry, I'll take some question from the audience. Yeah, there are some couple of questions addressed to Pak Nindyo, but he's no longer with us. And questions in, I like to address to Pak Iman, yeah. Yeah, a couple of questions to Pak Iman. What scenario impact to mining contractors or other business like trading? Is this question from Yuliarto Abadi? And the second question, it's a relevant question, I believe, from Muhammad Izuddin. One of the positive impact of digitalization in mining is friendly, to have friendly, environmental friendly mining activity. Please explain. So Pak Iman, bisa direspon pertanyaan ini?
Ya, baik. Terima kasih Pak Hendra dan Bapak-Bapak.
So it's a good question, Pak. I think first of all, I will answer the one of the question that asking about what is the impact of having digitalization implemented in our operation. So as I said before, that again, of course, this is depend on the scale of the operations. From the operating cost point of view, we can say that we can lowering the operating cost by having 15% to 25% of the lower operating cost. It could be more if then we have larger scope of operation, for example, pit to port. And then maybe I can directly answer the question number two, because unfortunately Pak Nino is not here, but what I'm seeing is how we can do a synergy between industry player, especially in Indonesia. We usually very familiar with the mine owner is contracting the works to the main contractors, while both of the mine owner and mining contractor has implemented the digitalization. So how we unlock the potential benefit of this transformation of this digitalization? So jika memang kita bisa merubah atau bersinergi, bagaimana how we synergize between mine owner and mine contractor, and of course within the coordination with the government, if then we can lowering the operating cost on both side. Of course, as Pak Nino expectation, we can reach more resources, or we can conserve more resources to be mined due to lowering the operating cost. So maybe that's the explanation, Pak Hendra.
Okay, thank you, Pak Iman from Petrosi. This is a question from from Mr. Narayanan. He asking the how to reach Eduardo and Alex, yeah. How to reach. So you, Mr. Posato and Sir Sander can reply directly to this in the chat column, yeah, from Narayanan, yeah. Okay, one question from Morawandi, Mr. Morawandi. He's concerned about the level of security in digitalization. So maybe Pak Andreas can, you know, provide some insight, and also Alex and Eduardo, if you'd like to jump in also, please.
Alex, Eduardo, I give the the pleasure and then the priority for you to answer. Later, maybe I can add. Yeah.
All right.
Can you just please repeat?
Maybe you can repeat the question. Yeah. Sorry, Pak Hendra.
Yeah. Basically, Mr. Morawandi, he's asking his has a concern about the level of security. Yeah.
Security.
Yeah. Level of security. Yeah. Because you know. We've been hearing some negative information about the information's leakage, you know, even the most trusted government database has been hacked and so on.
Yeah. I can start that as per the second presentation we had, we saw that one of the important topics on the digital transformation is actually cybersecurity. And there is actually many strategies that can be followed in terms to protect your own data. Some servers that are localized on premise, avoiding some cloud systems that are not very well protected. But I believe that if we follow the trends in the market with the most well-known players, like Tibico, for example, and following their advice in terms of which equipment to use and where to store their data, how to create your protocols of communication, how to authenticate the users. That should be, is already a very, very good first step. In terms of cybersecurity, there is always a risk that someone will find a way. What you need to look at is vendors that have been proven in the past that when they were attacked, they managed to respond quickly and protect the data quickly. I think that avoiding attack forever, it's almost an impossible task, is how you respond to attacks and how quickly and how well these vendors and will provide support for these organizations in terms of recovering what was lost and actually blocking again whatever needs to be blocked so to avoid other attacks. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you want to add anything else.
No, I think just to complement on what you said, it is, I guess it's a risk, and it to a certain level, it can be inevitable that this will be happening, like that there will be targets for attacks. But as Posato said, TIBCO and our clients and Visagio, we always work together to ensure that the infrastructure, the technologies are in place to protect us from that as much as possible. That in the form of authentication methods and domain restrictions, and all of those protections are set up in place and constantly audited and reviewed to ensure that as far as technology can help us protect from that, we are using the very best standards at every time.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you. I think in addition, yeah, of course, like TIBCO is a company who only one thing about data, right? And of course, we have to make sure about the data security, compliance, governance, right? We do also have all the solution for that. And then we basically also embrace all the level of security, because as we know, right, security come with the many levels from the network, right? From the inside, maybe from the devices, from outside, right? Also from the application level and data level. And just to give you one example, mainly in most of TIBCO solution, right? About how we basically provide the user access is when people call it as a, you know, like data masking, everything. We can basically give an access and also security even to the row and line level. So it's more than just like a file, even go beyond that, right? So, but that's probably what I can add here. We do also align with all the security and all certification, GDRP on board, you know, all of these things. Yeah, because besides mining, we also work very well with telcos and healthcare. And I think healthcare, mm-hmm. finance, and telco also especially healthcare, right? Just the industry whereby they really, really wants to make sure all the data, right? The data confidentiality, right? Healthcare and also the finance, of course, beside the mining itself. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you, Pak Andreas. Okay, next question. I will take the questions from Pak Muhammad Agung nih. Yeah, is asking question directly to Pak Iman, yeah. So the question is, how much impact of the digital transformations in Petrosi's company overall performance, Pak? I think you have covered it in your presentation, but yeah, if you don't mind, please.
Yeah, Pak Hendra, thank you, Pak. Yeah, I have answered before that, yeah, the total impact is depend on the large, on the scale of the operation. Of course, we can say that from the pit to port operation, we can at least minimum lowering by 15 to 25-30% of the operating cost. Yeah.
Okay. So yes. Yeah. All right. Okay. Thank you, Pak Iman. So, Pak Andreas, again. The presentation were very comprehensive and excellent from Visagio. So how the needs for the companies to, you know, to do the mining, the diagnostic, or to go through the sixth level of maturity, how ini apa yang mendorong gitu, Pak, ya, apa this is my pertanyaan dari awam aja, ya, apa yang kira-kira yang
I think even in any industry or any company, right, there's always an external and also right. internal factor, right, to basically encourage at sometimes to force a company to change to become a better company, including the digital transformation. It always if you go down to the basics, it always come into three things. Yeah, number one is about how to get more revenue opportunity, right? About revenue growth, right? And secondly, it's about how to manage the cost of the operation, right? And then the third one is always about controlling and mitigating the risk. Like, for example, I think as Pan Ninyo also mentioned, right, the cost of mining become higher, but then the ore, right, what we have is also very hard now, harder to mm-hmm. to mine, right? And then mm-hmm. there's so many regulation that if the mining company violate, there will be a very significant fine or allegation and so forth, right? So in mm-hmm. mining, we are talking about it is much harder to improve to have a revenue growth. On the other hand, how to manage the cost of operation as manageable as possible, right? And then the third one, how to mitigate the risk, right? So mm-hmm. to avoid company being fined and so on and so forth, right? And this is where I think Visagio, if I can give a summary, give a good solution together with TIBCO. Because again, all of these things start with the data. And like what I think Visagio solution, the challenge is that the data is silo, right? There's a silo of data, right? And then how basically Visagio can make it into one, right? Into unified, right? And then after that, when it is unified, not only to analyze all the historical data, not only to visualize the historical data, but more than that, yeah, they are with TIBCO, mm-hmm. they are able to predict, right? To predict, and not only to predict, also to have a what if scenario. And then so that if, let's say, the KPI showing, you know, decreasing, right, the company can simulate, right? They use word manipulate, right? But ini bukan kayak manipulasi dalam bahasa sehari-hari ya, tapi mungkin maksudnya simulate, right? If let's say they increase certain indicators, how basically impact to the result, right? And then all of these things will be possible more than just analytics, but it has to be combining with the predictive. TIBCO also have like a data science, AI, and also streaming for the real event. Yeah, currently, I think all Pak Iman also agree with me, right? What's the point to have all the historical data? Yeah, now the most important thing is the real event. What is currently happen? So it has to be able to get a streaming or real event, and also with that predicting what happened. Yeah. I know, I think Alex and Eduardo, you want to, I try my best to summarize what you've done.
That was great. That was great. Yes, actually,
maybe you want to add something more, right? Sorry to maybe to...
Yeah, I just want to add that when we talk about digital maturity, we usually segment that to specific processes as well, and in specific departments and specific technologies within the organization. So it's hard to say that one company overall is in one single location. It's in one maturity. Mm-hmm. But whenever you want to analyze specific departments, specific processes, that's the best way to look at it. So I'll give you one quick example that we use TIBCO for a process that gets us to level 6. So we have a case where we need to trigger alerts for the whole organization, or not the whole organization, but at least a few important people about possible dust events during one day, during the next day. So we're talking about environment and dust in the air. So basically air quality. Mm-hmm. So we have data that comes from forecast system that gives you wind speed, wind directions, temperature, humidity mm-hmm. for the next couple of days. We also know the plan of how much or mm-hmm. we move from one place to another for that day. With that, we can create some advanced analytics and try to infer roughly how much dust that will be generated. If mm-hmm. that goes above a certain threshold, what we did using TIBCO created some alerts that trigger an RPA process, a robotic process automation, that went to SAP and raised the notification in there already saying that there was a high risk of event. So if you see, we predicted, and we got to the mm-hmm. last level, which is adaptability, where even the decision made to raise a notification in SAP, even that decision was automated. That's the adaptability. Is you based on data, trustworthy data, and the calculations and risks, you make assumptions and mm-hmm. make actions in the business that eliminate the need to have someone to interpret something that can be easily interpreted by code or by DAO.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Posato. Pak Adianto, ada pertanyaan lagi dari audience nggak yang mau raise hands? Okay, mungkin nggak ada. Yeah, I believe there is no questions directly from the audience. Yeah, but I'll take two last questions, and I want all of you to respond it very briefly. It's a question actually addressed to Pak Nindyo, but he's no longer with us, but it's relevant to you, I guess. Yeah. So the first question is, how long do company transform to become technology centered? This is a very general question. So please, based on your experience doing working with the clients, Pisajo and Pak Iman, with your experience in your Petrosi case. And the second question is, how much do investment cost of this initiative? It's a very general again, but yeah, please respond it. That's like last one. Yeah, please start dari mana? Pak Andreas dulu ya. Andreas and followed by Posato and Sander and Pak Iman, the last one. Yeah, please.
Yeah, I think it's very complex question. We cannot that generalize every company. And digital journey is a journey, right? So we always need to know where we are, right? Like for example, if somebody asks me how does it take to have a trip, I will ask where you are now and where is your destination, right? So if somebody told me that I'm now in Jakarta and then my final destination is in Bandung, then will be 2 hours, and the 2 hours, by the way, is via the road, right? But then I think that's very general answers. I will leave to Alex and Eduardo as a management consultant, who I think this in, this out, as getting this question. So Alex and Eduardo, maybe you want to give some answers.
Thank you, Andreas. You are correct when you said it is different in every company, right? And this is because it is a journey. And like I try to say in our presentation, each different journey will have a different origin point. So you're starting from somewhere, and that can already change between different companies. And not only you're starting from a different place, it's likely that depending on the business and where you are and how much you're willing to invest, that you may stop a little early than other companies as well. So identifying that is crucial to understanding how much effort do we put in one aspect or in another aspect. And another thing that I wanted to mention is, we're talking about digital transformation, but digital transformation is not necessarily only about capacitating in technology. It's not only about a technology transformation. It's an actual combination of your technology ramp up with the culture changes that need to happen in people to be able to support that and work like that and behave in a way that you know, leverages from that. And also the third pillar, which is the strategy. So if you're bringing technology, if you're accelerating business, if your people is starting to change their mindset, this is much likely to impact your strategy as well. So all of this is a part of this transformation that companies go through. And each case that Visagio works with tends to be treated separately. Of course, we do bring a lot of experience every time we engage with a client to achieve a result in transformation. We do use that as baggage to drive better insight or to be even quicker on bringing transformation for others. So that's all accumulating as we speak. But it is a journey that is different. Yeah. What we do as well is, as Posato mentioned, for example, if the company is really big, you may have departments that are at maturity 6, and you may have departments that are at maturity 3. You may have systems that are at maturity 2 and systems that are at maturity 5. So that does happen. And what we tend to do as well as Visagio in some situations is we do implement what we call digital acceleration units. So basically bring in a few of our consultants to a specific sector or segment of a business, and we accelerate that sector of the business so it can catch up with the rest. And then from that, use this as the next step to plan for something more ambitious, you know, that drives better transformation.
I think the most important thing is to have a quick win, right? Mm-hmm. Of course, the company, or let's say maybe Pak Iman also cannot wait for your team, Pak, to say, oh, okay, the journey will take you 5 years. Right? That's too long, right? I think exactly. You will not approve, right? But that's why I think it's like we have a journey, but we do have a transit, and then we can enjoy in every step of the way, right? As people say, right? Even any journey, it starts with next few steps, and we can celebrate di beberapa on the way, right? So
yeah, on the way.
I think like
at the rest area,
just to give you a bit of example, like currently TIPCO, we are doing a master data management project, how to unify the data. Maybe in this case, sorry, because currently it's in more in the healthcare company. It's about customer domain, patient, right. Product, and account. And it takes this first project. It takes around 6 months, right? And then so within 6 months, there's already some a quick win that we can celebrate. But I believe maybe later Eduardo and Alex can give some example on current project, right. Or even Pak Iman definitely will be the main risk, the more valid resource based on the bankruptcy experience, Pak Iman.
Yeah. Thank you, Pak Andreas. Thank you, Soposato and Sander. Pak Iman,
Pak.
Thank you, Pak Hendra, Pak Andreas. Yeah, of course, Pak. So when we are talking about the how long it takes for the digital transformation journey, people are often saying about the people, process, technology, and I fully agree with Alex and Eduardo. It depends on the culture and the vision of the company itself on how they set the vision of the digital transformation journey. But yeah, from our experience with the condition of our company, we have proven that we can embark and finish until the successful of the transformation journey in only within 6 months. So hopefully we can also give the encouragement to other company to follow our journey. And second one, maybe as my last statement, Pak Hendra and everyone, again, back to the urgency of the digital transformation. It is very critical to all the stakeholder, especially the industry player like us, to start to embark the transformation journey, because this is not only to sustain the company in the long term, but it's also to to maintain the relevancy of the present of the company. And of course, we have proven that we can pass the very difficult in last 2 years in the pandemic situation. The digitalization is one of the key on how we can survive on maintaining our operating cost. Thank you, Pak Hendra, Pak Andreas.
Thank you very much, Pak Iman from Petrosi. It's been very interesting discussion, gentlemen, but unfortunately we are running out of time. So thank you, Mr. Posato, Mr. Sanders, Pak Andreas, Pak Iman, for your participation. It's been very insightful. So we'll go back to Desi and Pak Adianto to close the sessions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bahendra. Well, this brings us to the conclusion of today's session. Ladies and gentlemen, we've come to the end of webinar Accelerating Mining Digital Transformation in Indonesia. Thank you, everyone, for your participation. We hope the information provided was insightful and answered some of your questions. Thank you very much to all excellent speakers, Bapak Sunindyo Suryo Hardadi, Mr. Eduardo Posato, and Mr. Alexander Sander from Visagio, thank you very much. Bapak Iman Darus from Petrosi, terima kasih Pak Iman. And thank you to Bapak Andreas Kagawa, Country Manager at TIPCO. And of course to our moderator, Bapak Hendra Sinadia, Executive Director at Indonesian Coal Mining Association. Thank you for your time today and for your presentation in providing information and also some experience on digital transformation, especially in mining industry. I would like also to give a special thank you to our sponsor, TIPCO Software Indonesia, for your collaboration in making this event happen. Stay safe, stay healthy, and stay connected, everyone. Goodbye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. kasih Pak Hendra. Thank you Pak Iman.
Satu,
terima kasih Pak Hendra. Yes.
Recording stopped.
Terima kasih Pak Dianto.
Terima kasih Pak Iman.
Yeah, thank you.